Hello, it's Sarah. So I'm going to attempt to film a quick tutorial on these little ATCs. I've had a request. It is I would call this a ZIA ATC. ZIA stands for Zentangle Inspired Art, because a Zentangle is really an abstract design that you can kind of, it's more like this. Something that has no top or bottom or front or back. It's just from any direction. So, oops, that's Kirby. They consider this when you make it into a design, or say, like, where are my other ones? Like, I have this, I don't have any out like this one. That's Zentangled, and it's similar. It has strings that you create the design with, but it is a picture of something. So like this is upside down because it's a heart. I think this is considered ZIA. So anyway, that's what we're gonna do today. And what I've been doing, oh, just so you know, this is actually done on Canson, here it is. This is just cheap watercolor paper. It is cold press, let's see, 90 pounds. So it was very inexpensive. It was on sale, and I bought a bunch of them when I was doing mail art. So any watercolor paper, what I do is cut it down to an ATC is artist trading card, and it is 2.5 by 3.5. So you cut down your paper to 2.5 by 3.5. You can use any kind of paper. I am going to be coloring this with my Tim Holtz distress marker, so that's why I'm suggesting watercolor paper. Oops, don't need that. And then I back it with a piece of some type of a stronger piece of paper. So this is actually a file folder, a manila file folder, that I cut down into 2.5 by 3.5, and then I just glue it to the back. And it just makes it more substantial. So because the watercolor paper, it's kind of flimsy. So, all right, so what do I have here? I wanted to show you real quick too, is I'm not gonna be working on an ATC tonight. I am gonna do it on these little canvases, and I'll show you. These come in a 6-pack. They're white mini canvases, and I've had them in my stash forever, so I decided to play with them. They come individually wrapped, and I've already used the other 5 from the pack, or opened them. These are 2 that I made. I'm going to make these into magnets, but just because I liked the thickness of them. And I did try to work just on the straight canvas, and I did not, where are they? Here they are. These are my 2 prototypes. This one I did with the number 1 micron pen. Oh, the other thing we're going to be using is these. I love them. They're the Pigma microns. Let's see. I would suggest a 01, definitely. The 01 is my fave. This one is, oops, hold on. 01. You're going to do your detail lines with that. But I usually do my border with either a number 1. This definitely the number 1. This is what I did all these thick lines with, is the number 1. A little too wide on here for that, but I did do the border, just the line around the edge with the number 1, and then I used the number 08 for the patterning. But this is what I wanted to show you. Oh, it's dry now. But when I first did it, you can see the smudge. Like, it was just smudging really bad. This canvas is treated with gesso, but it says, let's see, titanium acrylic gesso primed. So I don't know, but it's like a slick surface. Like, here's one that hasn't been, I mean, it's really nicely primed, but it's, I don't know, it doesn't have that tooth. It kind of seems like it's a little bit shiny. So after and plus it's bumpy, and my pen was kind of taking a beating on there. So that was just as it is, and that's how that one turned out. And then I did, oh, come on, Sarah, where is everything? I keep losing everything. There was another one. Here it is. Sorry. I'm so sorry. Okay, this one. This one I gessoed. So I just took my gesso, which is just a regular, it's over there. What's it called? I think it's called acrylic gesso too. But it wasn't, it didn't seem like it had any shine to it. It was much more matte finish. So, and this one turned out okay. It did smudge a little. But it was still, my pens were taking a beating on the canvas, so I didn't like that. I mean, it turned out okay. It looks really painterly is what the word is when you, even though my tray is totally crooked, but, the pens, I just didn't feel right using the pens on the canvas. So what I decided to do was to cover the canvas with a piece of watercolor paper. So see, you can kind of see, there's, you know, it's just like I've left a little frame around that I kind of matted it like I would if I were doing it a card or something. I just cut it down so that it had that frame around it. And then, so I'll show you exactly. I am going to put a little bit of glue on the more like textured side of the paper. There's like a much more smooth side and a texture side. So I'm gonna actually put the glue, and this is the, you can use, I've used some glue stick lately for gluing. I've been trying to switch around glues and see what's what, but this is my good old Scotch Quick Dry, my go-to. I come back to that all the time. But I try not to get the glue on the paper. It's gonna happen, but I try not to because, and I just take an old wet wipe and kind of push down. Because it acts as a resist, I found out. On a couple other ones, I'll show you, like where I got glue on the paper, which I think I did again. I got some there, which I could probably get it off with water, maybe. Kind of, because it is watercolor paper. But that's all I do. And then when you just want to do your border, I take that number one, and you can just basically run right along the edge of that watercolor paper, and it'll create that nice border around your picture. And I'm not going to work on this one because I'm going to let that dry. I have another one over here that's I did earlier that's nice and dry. I know for sure it's dry. So like I said, you're just going to take that number one or whatever size marker you have. I mean, I like the bolder line around the border personally, but you are the artist here and you decide. So the first thing you want to do is create your the main lines, like the coloring book lines, I'm going to call them. You know, when you color in a coloring book, those bold lines that are going to be your design. So for me, I like to do the hills first, kind of set up my landscape here. Let's see if I'm gonna do it this way. I can point it down a little more maybe. No, sorry. I'm gonna have to go away and come back in a minute anyway. All right, let me just stay right here. So the first thing you're gonna do is kind of make a hill. And then I make another hill. And I kind of keep them on the lower half of the, now this is not an ATC. You have much more room on your ATC. So see how big my hills are on there? And I like that. Like I like how tall that one is. And I like putting my house over here because then you have a longer path. So it's cool. But I've played with all kinds of, like my house isn't over there all the time. See, I have my tree over there on this one. So let's see. On this one, my house is over there. But on this one, there's a tree. So it's fine. You can play around with your placement. I think this one's the one I just did, the last one I did. But I think, see, look at this. I put the gold wink Estella on there, but I think I got resist. See how that didn't take color? Because I think I had glue on there. Like there's a little spot here that didn't take color. There's a couple spots. I think that's what's happening is the glue acts as a resist. So if you're noticing that, maybe glue when you're done. First, do your ATC on your watercolor paper and then glue when you're done, completely done. And by the way, I didn't spray my ATCs, but I sprayed the first two, the very first two, where are they? These two. I sprayed these with a matte varnish. So just a Krylon matte spray. I went in the basement and I just gave them a quick coating when I was done watercoloring and everything, and I gave them a spray. Because see how the Winkostella does smudge it. So you should add that after. If you have a matte Krylon spray, spray it when you're done watercoloring, and then you won't get any more smears. But, you know, I don't mind that it's smeared, but then you can add Winkostella stickles, because I do add Winkostella and stickles. And then I varnished it on top. I just did it with a brush on varnish too, because these are going to be magnets. So I wanted them to hold up a little bit more. And these I did too. I didn't show these. But these are with the black, and this is on the white again, the same little canvas, but I put a piece of black cardstock. I did it with the jelly roll pens, my gold leafing pen, and then a black magic marker, one of these thick black magic markers, and I just went around the edges to kind of make it look like it was black. And then Dream, I did the same way. So but I varnished these after I sprayed them with a matte so they wouldn't smudge. All right, sorry. Let me see if I can do this with it in front of me. I think I might be able to if I get, because I kind of write like this. So let's see. Let me go back to my number 8. And this is an 08, not an 8. It's an 08. Oh, you can't see it because of my light. Anyway, trust me, it's an 08. So now we're going to put a little sun. And I just like to do kind of a smallish one right in the corner, and then I'm going to put my house. The next thing, I'm going to put my house kind of over here, and I'm going to put the two trees that over here this way instead of this one. Let me see. Because I want my path to be like this. I want to have a big path, so I'm going to do it this way again. So I'm going to put my house, and I just do the bottom, and then I like my roof the way I've been doing it here, but you can do your roof any way you want. I got this idea from the Frugal Crafter, Lindsay. This design is pretty much her idea. I changed it a little bit, but I did kind of, I was very inspired by her design. So now I'm gonna add, let's see which tree. I'm gonna add the taller tree, this one, and it's kind of like a mushroom tree. And then there's this, oops, I forgot this line. And this is very coloring book, and this one has more of a branchy trunk. You just kind of make three branches, and then you make like a swirly tree. Now, I like to keep them spaced and leave room at the top because you want to write your sentiment. But that way we have room to put lots of little doodles, like little leaves and flowers and butterfly and stuff like that. So now I'm going to flip this around, and I'm going to put some rays. And Lindsay, I want to say Lindsay, but I don't think that's her name, the Frugal Crafter. You guys know who I mean. She makes her sun swirly, but I couldn't do that consistently, so I just went with the straight, good old triangle style. And I make some tall, some short. They're not all perfect. I mean, my house is looking wonky too, but it'll look cute by the end, all right? So that's your main coloring book. Oops, nope, we got to do our path, and this is how I do my path. I kind of go down and then come out as if it's getting wider as you come down the hill. That is the main, yeah, that's it. Now, for the sentiment, I'm liking using like a number 3 or a 5 because, let me see, like on my first one, see how big it is when you use the number 1? It's a little too big. So I just prefer either a number 3 or a number 5. So I'm going to use the number 3 this time and we'll see how it goes. And I kind of shoot for having my heart over the house. So I just put home is where my heart is. So I'm going to start up here. Home is where. And then I'm going to put the heart right over the house. My heart is. And that's pretty good. I mean, I've done worse lettering. And then I'm going to go back to my number 8 and make a little cloud around it. So I'm just going to go right around the house and up. So that's your sentiment. And I mean, you could place it wherever you want. I had it originally like more over in the center, but my house was in the center. So it's kind of, I kind of shoot for putting the heart over the house. Let's see my ATCs. Did I do all them? Because I did a ton. I'm going to have to go away and change my battery. But I'm going to get the ones out that I see how this one's not directly over the house, but it's still cool. The ATCs have so much more height and room that it's easier to play with it. See, this is cool. I like the spacing on this one. All right, so I'll be right back. I got to change my battery. Okay, so these are the original ones I did when I was first playing with it. And this is my very first one. And you'll see that it's quite different. I have a chimney on my house. You're welcome to do that. I told you, she does the little twisty sun rays, which I just didn't like the way mine are. I mean, they look pretty cool, actually. Not bad. I love how this tree is so much bigger than the house, too, which is more realistic. I have these like little mushrooms over here that I haven't been putting, which are super cool. And maybe then my sentiment just kind of goes in the corner and is kind of going down like that. So that's one of them. And I put the butterfly in the sky there. That's number one. Then this is number 2. It's, let's see, I have 2 of these trees on here. I'm still doing the swirly sun rays. But my house is quite a bit smaller. And I put the sentiment more centered. So that's my second one. Then this one, I just kind of tightened up these 3 things. My sun is much bigger, but I have the pointy rays on here. So the house is bigger. I mean, you know, I just kept playing. I wonder if I changed my background. No, I like the swirly sky. And then this one's cool. I still have the straight rays. I put silver leafing pen around the edges of this one, I think. And I did gold around the edges of this. You can't really tell. Much bigger house. I added a window. My trees are little but much closer together. I have a nice sentiment there, nice and spaced out nice. And then this is the last one. So every single one looks different, you know. That's the thing. So they're all little works of art, and that's why I love them so much. All right, so we're getting back to this now. Like I said, this is a bit narrower, so I've made everything smaller and spaced it out. But what you really want to know, oh my God, how is my battery dying? This is really, really weird. I have one. No, I don't. I don't know. I'm going to keep going till it ends. Oh, well, you know what we didn't put is his little face. I'm going to do... This is the Frugal Crafter's sun face as well, and I love it. So I'm going to show you this. It's super cute. You just go down the center, make a nose, and then some lips and a chin. And you put little eyes like that. And that's it. That's all I do for my sun. I'm going to go switch it to my 01 Micron pen. Micron 01. The best pen ever. You can make such tiny little lines. It's awesome. And the first thing we'll do is, and you know, my home is where the heart is, isn't showing up as dark, but All right, the first thing I want to do is, this grass is so easy, all I do is echo the line of the path. And when I start running out of like swirls like this, I just do be a little more intentional, because it starts to get a little straight. I don't know why. And this is patterning. And if you were zentangling, it would just be patterning inside a space. That was just a random space. It's not supposed to be anything. But because this was grass, I thought it would kind of have the look of a hill. I don't know, like a hill kind of coming toward you. There are so many patterns. Oh my gosh. And people actually knew the names of the patterns, like by heart and stuff. I don't. Look how crooked that got. It doesn't matter. It still looks cool. And then this one, I liked how I just did it on this one last time. I just made the line, I didn't do anything fancy. I just made them kind of start tighter on this side and go wider down to give that look of a hill. And this is, I don't know what it's called, but it's kind of like, it looks like a cushion. I like that pattern. You know what, we're gonna do the house first. Let's do that. So all I do for the house is like bricks. And I think we all know that pattern. We used to do that when we were kids, probably most of us, because you know, you just make little rectangles, then you go in between all those lines. And if you can see, I mean, this will make you need glasses for sure. The window kind of got in the way there, so I'm, without being on top of it, I can't really see where I'm going. But you get the idea. You're doing a brick. Here we go. Like a brick. There we go. And then the roof is a cool one. You make a triangle pointing up. And not, don't butt right up against each other. Leave a little gap in between. Then put like a T, the top of a T on top. And then make another triangle connecting your T's. And then make that T again, and then connect it with your triangle. And it kind of looks like roof shingles. That's what I thought. When I saw that pattern, I thought, oh, that's the one I'll use for the roof. And like, I mean, I've done them wide, and this one's kind of tall. So every single one, it's just gonna look different. It just is. Like these are the ones on the, ATCs, like that's a smaller roof. All right, but see how I did the bricks? They're huge on this house. They're smaller on that house. And then don't forget about the door. I just make vertical lines. Now for the path, I love this. I kind of do it like a cobblestone. So I just start out with two little stones, and then just like you do the bricks, make one under each separation. It's hard to see. As we go down, they get bigger and you'll be able to see. But these are kind of like oval stones, and I'm just putting one underneath where the other two touch type thing. So it's still that brick pattern, but they're rounded stones instead of, actually these are kind of oblong, they're not round. And you can actually get really big toward the bottom and just end it with a big one like that. But I think that kind of looks cool too. It looks like it's coming toward you. Another one, oh, an easy one, since my battery's blinking, I just do a simple stripe on the sun rays. And on the tree trunks as well. They're just simple. I just kind of do, oh, I think I did like a checkerboard. But this is just such a thin area. I just didn't want to leave it plain. And I tried doing it like more intricate before. But I think this is a kind of, it just fills the space and it It looks cool. So that's what I do for the tree trunks. Then the trees. I love this pattern. It's just circles. Go around and make circles, kind of the biggest ones you're gonna make. Then in the spaces that you've left, go for more medium-sized ones. Fill in, kind of making medium-sized ones, right? Now you have little spaces left. You're gonna put teeny tiny ones to fill all the spaces that you've left. You're gonna put a circle, and this pen will do it. It's an 01, and you can make tiny little circles. It is amazing. And I'm not right over this, so I hope I'm kind of doing a good job. I try to be. Zentangle, or this patterning, it doesn't have to be perfect, guys. That's the one thing, but look at that. Okay, so I got another battery. I just hope it holds out. Then this tree, I love this tree with these little leaf shapes. So I put like four here, teardrops or leaves, I don't know. And then I put a couple kind of going out from the base, from the trunk. Then you just start filling in, like stick your in between each other. Again, it's more like that brick pattern where you're kind of in between the other one. And make these little oval teardrop leaf shapes. And that's it. So your tree is done. Mushroom tree. Now we just have this hill and the sky. So for the hill, you know what we'll do? I'll show you this pattern, the cushion. And you can do it kind of getting bigger like this. I like to keep it narrow and then big. Narrow, big, narrow. So that looks pretty cool, right? It gives the illusion of something. I don't know. Then you have to make another kind of curved line. And this is the first time I've ever really done it like thicker and thin. So I'm just seeing what this looks like. I have no idea what this is going to turn out like. It kind of makes it look hilly. All right. Now, on the top of the curve, so on the top of the arch of the top of the curve, you're going to make little arches connecting each corner to corner of each square on top of the curve, on top of each curved line. So you do that all the way down, and you're going to do it again on the other top of the other curves. I'll show you. So that's all those, and then you turn it, and this is, see how it's curved that way. This is the top of the curve. You just do the same thing from corner to corner of each square, and that's it. Then that pattern, I mean, you can add, there's so many variations of these patterns. I think I've added a little dot in the corner, in the corners. So I'll show you what I mean. But basically it's just a little, let's see, did I get them all? Sometimes you miss them. And then, I mean, you could put a little dot in the middle of each corner of each square. It just adds color, like more pop, you know, more bold. So it's just another variation, they call it. Okay, now the sky. Now for the sky, and this was the Frugal Crafter too. She did these swirly sky, and I changed it to kind of make it more subtle. And I like to just, I want to keep a line so that I can put a garden in between. So I don't want to bring my sky down too far is what I'm saying. So I just like to start making swirls. And I'm going to leave that, and then I'm going to, a little bit more here. I think I'm going to leave this. I could take this around one more time, but I'm going to leave it. And I'm going to start another one. I like them big. And just start your swirl here, and you still get the effect of that pattern, and that's it. I'm leaving that space. I'm going to put one in the middle of these trees. And I think I'm going to leave that space too, because that way you have more room for your little, see those little like flowery squiggles? I'll show you. Those are, I got from Zentangling, and actually no, from Google. I go to Google and I enter in Zentangle ATCs or something like that. And then you click images when it comes up, because websites will come up and stuff. But if you click images, all of a sudden you can scroll through tons of images of Zentangled ATCs. So I get so many ideas. I see other people's stuff, and like that's where I got this little butterfly we're gonna do. I'll show you. All right, we're almost ready to watercolor. But the first thing we're gonna do are these little, these are the coolest flower. You make this little triangle shape. It's very small. Hopefully you can see that. And I'm gonna put another one up here. And then you take and you go line, 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 dot, dot, dot. Line, 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 dot, dot, dot. And you can kind of change the direction of it. Then you add a stem and you add a stem. Then I'm gonna make a curly Q and a curly Q. I kind of made them a little close together, but see, that's the thing. You'll practice first before you just do this. Then I'm gonna do another curly Q and another one. And then you can even just do little, I don't know, stand up thingy-majabbies. Do a curly Q off of here. And then one more triangle thing right here. One, two, three, four, five. I like them, they're so cool. All right, we're gonna put a butterfly over here somewhere. Do you wanna put a butterfly here or here? I think, cause look, I like to put this little snail. This little snail is so cool. You just start here and you just make a curly Q. That's his body and that's his head. And then you put a little couple of antennas and you have a little snail. Isn't that adorable? I'm gonna fill this in a little bit. Like that. Then we're gonna do some more of those triangle ones. They're my favorite. And a triangle here. And boop, 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 boop. Make the stems and a curly Q. Curly Q. And you can do whatever you want. Make your own doodles. This is someone else's idea because I don't have any ideas. Pathetic, but true. All right, so I'm gonna do, like I'm a copycat, you guys. I'm totally not kidding. But, you know, it kind of becomes my own after. But anyway, so that's, he's a huge, he's like a Godzilla snail. All right, so what else? A butterfly. I should do it big first. I'm gonna grab a scrap piece of paper and show you what it's supposed to look like, because it's really hard to show you on the small. So you make a body and a head, all right? Then you kind of make a line across, and I'm gonna do this tiny, so it's not gonna look anything like this, but you're gonna make it square and connect, square and connect. So it's square over here, but then it's kind of hard to explain. And then he has antennas and a curly Q in the middle. And we're gonna do this tiny. So that's the idea, but you could do it like this. I mean, it's still gonna look like a butterfly, you know? But that's what I'm trying to do on here. It's so small. I'm thinking now to myself, why am I trying to do that? It's like crazy. Because that is a perfectly cute butterfly, just doing that, right? Super easy. And then you could just put a swirly in the middle. Hello. Should we just do that? That's a little hard. I think I'm gonna do that easy one today. I think I'm going to put them over. No, I'm going to put them in over here. I'm going to put them right here. So I'm just going to go head, body, and little wings, and little antenna. Oops. I mean, good enough, right? Then I want to do a big swirly flower and a big swirly. And then I gotta do my little triangles. I really should have done a triangle up here. See if I can do it, make it overlap. Shouldn't have done that. So that's the thing. Placement is an issue. You have to be kind of practice a few first. I would say play around on some scrap paper. And you know, honestly, that's why I did so many. I've done 8 altogether of the ATCs, and now I'm doing these. So I've done so many. I'm hoping that they're going to be cute as a magnet, because I haven't put the magnets on the back yet. I think they're really cool. I think someone will think that's a little work of art, right? I don't know. We'll see. I never know what people want at my craft shows. I make things and think they're super duper. People don't think so. All right, cool. So that's, I'm considering that done for now, okay? Now, I'm going with my standard colors here that I've been using. You know what? I'm going to make a house. I'm going to make it pink because that's what I have in my hand. I'm taking too long. All I have is my water brush and some Tim Holtz distress markers. So all I'm going to do is just, I'm going to turn this a little bit to the side, maybe come up a little bit, just so I have a little more room to work. I like to use this color here. This is called Iced Spruce on my path and my roof. And I just lay a little color down. I don't color it in all the way. And then I take my water brush and just kind of push the color around on the watercolor paper. That's it. I'm not, you know, getting crazy over it. It's pretty, right? I need a paper towel. Clean off your brush. Just literally dab it on a paper towel and the color comes off. Let's do the sun. I use, not this one, this one. This is called mustard seed. And I just take a little mustard seed and rub it on the sun. I'm gonna put a little bit in this window. And my water brush and just rub it in there, kind of soften it. And good. Now I'm going to just blot on my paper towel, and we're going to do the house. Might as well. Oh, you know what? Let me give me brown. Going to do the trunk and the trunks. Sorry, I hope I wasn't out of the shot. That is so annoying. The trunks and the door. And I'm really just getting color on there, and then I'm going to move it around with the water a little bit. Blot it on that paper towel so it get the color off. What else? I'm gonna do, I like to use this bright green. This is called Mowed Lawn. And I really just put it in the middle of the trees, kind of up against the trunk as best you can. And then I push the color up to the top with the water. Looks like the paper is peeling there. I don't know what happened. And see how it, like, it looks more like sheer toward the edges of the tree. And blot. Make sure you get the color off there before you go to the next color. This one's called Shabby Shutters. And I just kind of rub that all over this hill. It's a light green. And then I'm just going to kind of push it to the edges. Because it's really light. I didn't want to, I don't know what I didn't want to do. I'm tired, guys. It's late. Let's see. I need that dark green. I'm doing a tutorial of cord up. Oh, this one. One, two. I don't know where it is. Guess what? Nope, I don't want to use that. Let's skip it. The house is pink. And I just kind of go under the thing and three lines. I don't know. I just enough to get color, and then you're going to soften it anyway. That's good. And get that off the pen. I use this, I love this color too, Ripe Persimmon it's called. And I put that on my rays. I mean, you could do your rays yellow, keep them the same. I love that color. It's like, I can't even describe it. It's such a pretty orangey peach pink. I don't know. All right, and I can't find my green. I don't want to take. Where the heck are you? Right here. Sorry, it's called Peeled Pink, and it's kind of a darker green. So I'm just going to put it kind of on the edges there and there, and leave a lot of white space, because then when you just take water and add water to it, it'll move. It's going to come up here and fill in this whole hill, because it's got a lot of pigment, a lot more than the other. And that's it. So my hills and my trees and everything's colored. I'm going to do my sky. And to do that, I use the my lightest blue that I have is called Tumbled Glass. I've experimented with a little bit darker, but I really like the light blue. I go all along the bottom, kind of scribbling color on. And then we're just gonna move it around with the water. And that's it. See how it's not really all over? Oops, pulled off the wrong cap. And then make sure you have enough water in the brush. And I just kind of make swirly motions with my brush. And just move it around like that, because that way you'll have darks and lights, and it kind of looks like shadowy. I don't know. I'm not a professional watercolorer, and I'm sure there are techniques. I know how to paint with acrylics, but I think this looks pretty the way I do it. It just looks painterly is the word that I've heard before to describe it. It makes it look like it's hand painted. It wasn't done, you know, and sometimes the ink smudges a little, but it's okay. I'm gonna darken up my sentiment, but that's it. Pretty much it's done. The other thing I do is I put my Wink Estella on there. I would let it completely dry. I'm gonna darken up the sentiment. I'm gonna use I'm gonna use a number 5 05. When I say 5, I mean 05. I'm not using a 5. Whoops, that's an O. I have a lot of these suckers. Where is it? Here it is, 05. And I just really want to get it. I like a dark, crisp black line. Yeah, that looks prettier. It was kind of looking gray. I want it dark. And you could put home is where the heart is. I just put home is where my heart is. And I like that. So that's much darker. As I was saying about the spray varnish, you should probably let this dry completely. Maybe spray it with the Krylon. And then do any Wink Estella stuff and all that on top. That would be what I would suggest, because that way you won't get any smudges and smears, and you'll be really pissed that you just ruined your whole little work of art. but you can, like, here's the pink Wink Estella. I'll just show you, because I love doing this to the little the little snail guy. I don't know why I make them pink. Because I'm girly and I'm not girly, but I like pink. And I do the butterfly with my gold Wink Estella, which is somewhere not prepared. But the paper is a little wet, I can tell. But there, and it just adds a little shimmer and glitter and fun. So yeah, because you can tell it bled a little. So definitely wait, let everything dry, give it a coat, like I said, if you have it, of the Krylon, and then go crazy embellishing. So that's it. I hope you guys try it. It's super fun techniques, and make your own pictures. All right, you guys, thanks for watching.